Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, I want to hear about it. So does everyone else. Send me an email with all the details. You can send it to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Well, tonight's journey into Sasquatch Valley is going to be a riveting journey, I think. And it might be a tad bit long. So, go get your snackage ready. Load up those saddlebags and get ready to move out. We have a lot of trail to cover tonight. First of all, we're going to do a pit stop down in Kentucky. From there, we're going to head west over to Missouri. We're going to do a check-in with Dee, who we haven't heard from in a while. Now, after we say goodbye to Dee for tonight, we're going to head straight north. That's right. We're going up to True North territory into Canada. Northern Ontario, to be exact. So, are you ready? I know I am. Let's go. In 1979 or 1980, myself and my best friend and his wife went camping by the Licking River near Poindexter in Harrison County, Kentucky. I furnished the tent, Coleman stove, lantern, coolers, and most of the food. Later that night, when we were all going to sleep, I took my well-behaved dog, Snoopy, into the tent. She lay down over in the corner. Later on, I heard the two of them arguing. Turns out she was pissed off because I had Snoopy in the tent. So they packed their stuff up and they left. Later on, after midnight, Snoopy woke me up. She was growling and barking, and she wanted out of the tent. But being very protective of her, I did not let her out. There was something large out there walking around the tent. The leaves were dry, so I could hear it. And it was large, whatever it was, and it was heavy. It touched the top of the tent. I hollered a lot, and naturally my lantern out there on a tree limb was now out of fuel. I did not sleep the rest of the night. The next morning, me and Snoopy went to my parents' house in Oddville, and yes, that is the real name of the place. I borrowed my dad's pistol and several bullets, and we went back. I fished and I cooked lots of food that day, and Snoopy ate a lot that day. That night, I was ready for Bigfoot, or whatever it was, to come back. But nothing happened that night. Me and Snoopy left, but ever since then, when I'm out in the country, I keep alert. I have told only a handful of people about this. You can read my name out if you want. Signed, Larry Fowler. Hello, Nance. It has been a whirlwind here. I wanted to let you know I'm no longer living in near impossible, dangerous conditions. Thank God. Last August, the court awarded us siblings Mom's house. I sold my 5 acres to my nephew, but he's not living there. I told him what lives there. I'm scared for him. On very stormy nights, one of the Bigfoot still visits me in town. I don't give them a red carpet, but there are pets that people let out at night. They are just warm snacks, I'm sorry to say. All my windows remain blocked, you betcha. I will probably always do that. I am still in contact with the people who helped me to discourage these things, and I now have lights on all sides of the house but one. I pour a scent along my home, especially below windows and doors. I have PTSD, and I have begun my treatment, yet I do not feel good at all about sharing this truth yet. I'll bet this doctor has never seen one, but who knows? I've never had a doctor prove I'm crazy up front, but there's always a first. Honestly, though, I don't care to be mislabeled. I keep a jar of mothballs handy. I take the lid off and place it between my back door and the storm door on stormy nights. This is in the hopes that the odor will keep those things from proceeding to open the back door. I have had claw marks on the deck, and their arms are long enough to handle the door without ever stepping on the deck, which they have done. I have photos of their handprints on snow in the deck, where they picked up the fallen pecans in the winter. They've broken off maple branches on high to gather them for the buds, which they strip with their teeth. So, yes, they still visit, and they still slap the house up near above the toilet. This has resulted in damage to the siding. I figured out why they hit there. It's because the sewage vent is up near the roof right there. If they visit, they always hit the house in that area. I have a company that does all the mowing, and I have this yard looking like it was cut with a skull shaver, meaning there's nowhere out there to hide. I thought by now there would be nothing to gain by them sneaking to the house, but they've come at least 4 times this year. But it seems the females haven't come. It seems to be Mo or his son, Junior. They stay quiet when they come now. Well, I'm going to tell you if you desire. You may read this on your program because people have been very kind with kind thoughts and prayers. Just let them know I'm much better off now. I put a new roof on Mom's house. And some still have questions about the young female, Tanny. I know she's still on the 5 acres. I am beginning to wonder if their females inherit a territory. She still walks with a limp, but she has destroyed sections of fence to make it easier for her to get around. She should be having young, too. From there, she and the others have unlimited access to other expanses of timber. I know because we had satellite maps made. I will never forget June 23rd of 2007. I had a tumor burst. I was bleeding out. I had the window open a crack, and I tried to reach out to close the window. And I saw a pair of enormous legs in the south side yard, not more than 20 to 25 feet outside my window. It looked red-haired like the old female. Beside her stood a small set of legs from the thighs down, covered in sandy blonde hair, with the knobby knees of a child. Both were standing stock still, facing me. I had seen them before. The little one was Tanny. I had the blinds lowered so I couldn't see more of them. When I passed the window again, they were gone. The ambulance came, and I obviously had a rough time, but surgery saved my life. Tanny's hair got darker over time. She is the one that got aggressive with my tree crew in January of 2021. My nephew and my brother plan to clear the land, so it's not over by a long shot. Naturally, I'm safer, but I do worry for them. Love to you, Nance, and to all the squad. Signed, D in Missouri. Dear Nance at Buckeye Bigfoot, well, I have to tell you, I'm writing this to you only because I saw your live stream. You said something in that stream that sent shivers down my spine. Because you happened to mention something that was very similar to what happened to me. So here is what happened. I live in northern Wisconsin. Some years back after my father died, I inherited his cabin in the northern wilds of Ontario, Canada. Now, he acquired this cabin much later in his life, so I didn't get to go there when I was a kid. But we still had many years together to make a lot of good memories there before he passed. So I was very happy to get it and to keep it. Now, like my father, I also have a pilot's license. I also inherited his 1981 Cessna 172P. He always kept it in perfect shape, and so do I. Now, this is the best way to get in and out to that cabin, and it's definitely by far the fastest. In my professional life, I am an oncologist. It's a very rewarding, but also very difficult career. My father cautioned me before I chose this field of medicine. He himself had been a general practitioner of medicine, aka the family doctor, in a small town in Wisconsin. He said that just being a general med was stressful enough, and that's one reason he bought the land with the cabin. And it's why I now escape to it regularly. Going up there helps me to rebalance myself after a particularly bad cycle of patients. I don't mean that the patients were bad, but that their outcomes were. As to the cabin itself, it's small, with one room below and a small sleeping loft above. It's very rustic. There's no water and no electricity. I do, however, have a bank of portable folding cell panels for solar. I only use those for small items when absolutely necessary. Now, that is all the backstory I think you need. I went up there for a week in the summer of 2019. As usual, I brought all my water and food with me. And as always, I was careful with food and any trash, as black bears are not uncommon up there. The year before, I had found bear prints approximately 100 yards away from the cabin, and over the years, I have visually sighted them a few times, but always at a distance, and none had ever been a problem. Unless it happened with my father and I never heard about it, to my knowledge, those bear prints I found 100 yards away, that was the closest that I ever knew of any bear coming to the cabin. One night in July, it was cool that night, but up in the sleeping loft, the air felt really stuffy. There were two small vent windows up there in the loft. I opened the two opposing vents so I could get some cross airflow in. I tossed a couple of times, and I just started to feel drowsy and sleepy. And wouldn't you know it, after a few minutes of that, I felt the call of nature slowly beginning to build. I ignored it. I told myself I could wait till the morning because this was not the kind of nature's call that you could, you know, put in a Coke bottle or something, if you get my meaning. I did not want to have to get up in the middle of the night and go to the outhouse. I tried to convince myself, but my body just wasn't on board. I decided it was better to do it now than later. So I got up, went down the ladder, and got my battery-operated hand lantern. I swept the light around outside to make sure there's no bears out there. Then I went out to the outhouse and did what I had to do. I wasn't having any feelings of being watched or anything like that. I didn't smell anything, and I didn't hear anything. But honestly, I think I was more asleep than awake on that trip out to the outhouse. And I was sort of trying to keep myself somewhat asleep so I could just go back in and fall right back to sleep. Soon enough, I left the outhouse, went back inside the cabin, climbed up the loft, and tried to go back to sleep. I could feel the cool air coming in from the two vent openings, and I was almost drifting off to sleep when I heard it. The outhouse door creaked open and closed. Once, then twice, and then a third time. But on the third time, it was slammed shut with great force. Now my eyes opened when I heard the first creak, and I was definitely awake for the second. When I heard that third one, I sat upright and almost cracked my head on the cabin ceiling. I looked out the window near the head of my mattress, but it was total darkness out there. I had put the lantern on a shelf that was midway up the ladder to the loft. That's the place where it was normally kept. I kept it there so it was within reach from either the loft or from the main level. I had different thoughts going through my head right then. One is I was trying to explain away what I had just heard. I was thinking of all the different animals that could have done that. Maybe they were scratching up against the outhouse door. Maybe it had been the wind doing it. But I had never heard the wind do that because the door has a wood lever catch on it. So I told myself, that's it. I just hadn't closed it firmly enough to latch it. That's all. But then I had a couple of thoughts I did not like. What if it wasn't an animal or the wind? What if it was a person? Because now in my head I was retracing all my steps when I came into the cabin. Had I turned the deadbolt on the cabin door? I think I did. But had I? Had I locked the door? My habit is to leave that cabin door open during the days when I'm out and about doing things on the property. I don't like to carry my keys out there, but I do lock it at night. But I'm human, and many times I have forgotten because I've been tired. I mean, heck, more than once I've gotten up at my suburban home in Wisconsin only to discover that I'd left the garage door open all night, and the door into the house had been unlocked too. Good thing I live in a good neighborhood. But I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one who has forgotten to lock a door and went to bed. But in the over 40 years that I'd been up there on and off with my dad and now by myself, I had never had a single person wander onto this property. I mean, if they had, I sure wasn't here to know it. It's not out of the question, of course, but wouldn't be something that would happen regularly, as this property is, well, I don't like to brag, but quite substantial. As a physician, my dad had very deep pockets, as they say. And when he bought it decades ago when land was still relatively cheap. Point being, someone would have to walk a very, very long way through some difficult terrain to trespass near this cabin. I'm thinking of what it might mean if it's a person down there. And then I start walking through the scenario in my head of what I need. And I know that all of what I need is down on that cabin level, not up here. The light, the firearm, everything. I'm quickly shimmying back into my pants and getting ready to go down the ladder. When clear as day, I hear a sound at my cabin door, like something was fumbling. A half second later, my heart stops. I hear the cabin door open. Talk about blood in your veins turning to ice. Mine did right then. Now everything is in total darkness inside the cabin, but I'm trying to look over the ledge of the loft without announcing where I was. But I couldn't see a thing. I did, however, suddenly get a noseful of pungent, wet, dirty, moldy smell. So I thought, well, it must be a bear. I was not sure at this point what my best course of action was, but I needed to see exactly who or what was down there. I mean, I was pretty sure it was a bear. But what if I was wrong? I reached along the edge of the loft until I found the wall, and then I slowly felt downward with my right hand, and with my left hand, I steadied myself on the ladder. I knew the shelf was against the wall, about 4 ladder steps down, and there was a gap of about 2 feet between the ladder and the wall. So it was a bit like playing Twister in the dark, hanging almost upside down to get to that lantern. My fingers crept along the wood wall until I found the edge of the shelf, and then I found the lantern handle and quickly pulled it up over the loft. Also, I should mention that this lantern is not like some camping lantern. It's more like a great big boxy flashlight with a huge lens on it. My dad always called it a lantern, so I guess that's just what I continue with. It was pretty old and used one of those great big square batteries, but it was very bright. It was more like a boxy spotlight. Now, I'm sitting there in the loft and I'm weighing my options. If it was a bear, There was only one way in and one way out of the cabin, and that was the door. Because all the windows down there, in theory, I could get through them, but they were all locked and closed. I had to think about being trapped up in the loft if that bear decided to climb up and get me. I thought about bringing the ladder up, but I was pretty certain if that bear wanted to, it could get up to the loft. And depending on how big it was, maybe all it would have to do is stand on its back legs and just reach up. I mean, this was an old cabin after all. I believe it was built in the 1970s. It was not built with high ceilings like many of the hobby cabins that you see today are built. So, all of these things and so many more were going through my mind. Did I chance flipping on the light and blinding a bear and maybe angering it? If it was a person, I mean, they had to know I was in the cabin somewhere, right? They saw the spotlight lantern when I went out to the outhouse. At least, that was my assumption. So at this point, my mind is doing all these complex scenario walkthroughs and what-ifs. And then I don't know what happened. I was listening to it as it bumped into things. Things were hitting the floor, and I don't know where the impulse came from. I don't even remember having an impulse. Here I had just been contemplating what was the smart thing to do, and I threw it all out the window. I leaned over and I flipped on that light. I shined it right down to the bottom of that cabin. Oh my goodness, it was a bear, exactly as I had feared. And as I mentioned, as luck would have it, the only firearm I had was down there with the bear. Now, in a millisecond, I had one thought, and one thought only, and that thought was this. Man, that bear's got some long legs and big butt cheeks. I mean, even from up there, I could see the dark fur covering its legs and behind. There was also a moment of disassociation. I was trying so hard to see a bear that I was seeing a bear, even though my brain was rejecting the idea. Its back was to me, and when I saw the shoulders and the arms and the hands with opposable thumbs, somewhere in my brain I had to concede. I was not looking at a bear. Now, true, I might not have been a thoracic surgeon or anything of that nature, but I did know anatomy. And for the record, in my high school days, before I knew I was going to be an oncologist, I had flirted with the idea of some sort of zoological career path, and I studied a lot of animal anatomy and spent my weekends working part-time for one of my dad's friends, who was a veterinarian. I learned a lot from that man. So, I was confident that this was not a bear, and nothing on earth could make me think otherwise. But was it a human dressed in strange clothing? I saw the musculature. I saw the skeletal joinery underneath all of that fur. I saw its movements and the muscle movements under the fur, which was quite evident only mere feet away under the high lighting conditions of the spotlight lantern. And that lantern, by the way, it made the cabin interior glow in an unnatural white light. It was painful to look at. And it threw a dark shadow of the creature on the far wall of the cabin. All of these conditions made me squint. It was so bright. But at the same time, I saw it all with frightening clarity. It was reaching with its hands along the shelves, picking everything up, touching everything on the counterboards. It was picking up and sniffing everything within reach. I kept all my food and tins in the cabin because of rodents, but it knew which ones had food in them. It picked up one after another and would sniff it. I watched as it banged a tin with a half bag of Nutter Butter cookies in it, and then it banged it on the wall, next to the shelf that the tin had been on. It wanted what was in that tin. All the while, my eyes, stunned as I was trying to take in all the details. the dark brown, almost black color of the fur. How shiny and clean it looked in the light. I took note of how the fur on its back seemed to part out from the spine indent into a natural pattern that went from the spine around to the front. And while the fur on the back seemed to be shorter and close to the body, the hair starting at the waist and going down the back of its legs seemed longer, shaggier, and less shiny. Somewhere, my mind had told me that I had a Sasquatch in the cabin, that it was a Sasquatch I was looking at. Part of me knew it, but the other part, of course, was in denial about it, but only for a couple more seconds. Because at some point, that Sasquatch realized there was a light from somewhere, and it began to turn towards me and the light above. It started to turn, but it didn't finish turning because the light was so bright. It covered its face with a large hand, while at the same time lashing out with the other. It was knocking everything within reach all over inside the cabin. Its strength was evident. The large, solid wood table that my father had handmade on site inside the cabin was too heavy for me to move, but scooting for a few inches at a time. But this powerful creature knocked that table up against the wall on its side like it was a box of Kleenex. I was very frightened, but many times in my medical career, I have had to keep my panic and my fear under control. If I panic, if I act on fear, people can die. Now, true, that doesn't happen often right there in the oncology department, but there have been times that patients have gone into reactive states right there while having chemo administered. Their body rejects it. Something happens. They go into cardiac arrest. Not common, but it happens. And until the ER team comes from the other side of the hospital, I am the ER. So I must keep my head at all times. So that training came into play. I had the impression it wanted to get out of there, but I also knew that it really probably couldn't see because of the bright light. And I also knew there was no way I was turning that light off and leaving myself in darkness with a Sasquatch in the cabin. So I moved the light to point toward the cabin door. I wanted it to look that way and see that that was the way out. Instead, it took the reprieve of the light off of its face to renew its attack on the tins of food. At some point, the banging either popped the lid off or dented the side of the tin enough that it could pry the lid off. I watched in the semi-light of the back part of the cabin where the creature was. It took out the Nutter Butter cookies, and I heard the bag crinkle as it laid the bag of cookies on the wood board that I used as a counter. Then it began picking up another tin and another tin, sniffing them and tossing them. At one point, I just wanted it to leave, and in my frustration, I yelled at it. It stopped what it was doing, and it turned to look up at me. If you've ever stared down a gorilla who thinks you're challenging him, well, that's the look that I got back from this creature. It radiated danger. But it didn't do that until I yelled at it. At that point, I instinctively moved away from the edge of the loft, but I kept the light pointed across the top of the cabin to the wall with the door on it. I didn't know how this was going to end, but I promised myself if I got through this, I would never ever leave a door unlocked again. I would get up 100 times to check it before bed, and I would never ever sleep without a firearm up in the loft with me ever again. Now, I mention those thoughts because the one thought I did not have was that I was never going to come back there. Maybe another 3 or 4 minutes went by, and I was still hearing banging and things moving down there. I was hearing things being tossed, broken, and moved. But I did not dare peek over the edge of the loft again. Then I heard more moving, and then I heard the cabin door creak. Did it leave? I didn't know, but it was silent down there. I wanted very badly to look, but I was afraid it was a trap. I told myself if I could count to 100 with no sound coming from below, that it would be safe to look over the edge. I counted. I made it to 100. I crept forward and I shined the light over the edge and looked down below. Everything in the bottom part of the cabin was in shambles. But thankfully, there was no sight of the Sasquatch. There was still a stench lingering, and I did wonder if maybe it was right outside the door. I wondered if it was safe at all to come on down and shut and lock the door. Was it waiting for me? So I listened again for several minutes. Then before I could change my mind, I shot down the ladder, closed, and locked the cabin door. I was in shock, and I was a little shaky, but I thought it was over, finally. I sat down in one of the chairs that I pushed upright. I leaned up against the counter shelf. I was in disbelief. I looked around and I tried to take in all that had happened. Did I really just have a Sasquatch in the cabin? I was trying to understand not only what happened, but why. Had it seen the light when I went out to the outhouse? Was it out there as I was walking between the outhouse and the cabin? Why did it open the outhouse door a couple times? If it was looking for me, it should have known after the first time I wasn't in the outhouse. Did it not see me come back into the cabin? Well, then why did it come to the cabin? Why did it come in? There shouldn't have been any food smells to draw it in. The only conclusion I could draw was that it had been out there when I went out. It had seen me, and it had followed me. Coming in and having the door open, those were just opportunistic things, and taking the cookies maybe just made it all worthwhile. And I should add, it took more than just the nut butter cookies. It took a lot of different bits of food, and I think it ate some while it was down there. I had a lot of food missing. And as I worked to pick up and clean up all that mess, I reasoned out everything that had happened in just those few minutes. I'm also of the belief that what was in my cabin was either a juvenile or a small variety of adult Sasquatch. Oh, sure, it was a powerful and muscular creature, don't get me wrong. But as I have mentioned before, that cabin was not built with high ceilings. As a matter of fact, the loft they put in was almost an afterthought and only covers about a third of the cabin floor. Now that loft, the height under it, is just under 7 feet tall. I am 6'1", and I feel like that the ceiling, or rather the loft floor, is right on top of my head when I walk under it to go into that part of the cabin. Now, true, the creature did look as if it were slightly bent in order to get up under there to all the tins of food along the wall on shelves. But I don't believe it could have even been 7 feet tall. And it was more than likely just a couple inches taller than me. Maybe 6.5 feet? I spent the rest of the night up there in the loft, unable to sleep. I kept the vent windows open so I could hear if it came back, but it did not. And you can bet, I checked that door several times before I finally went back up to the loft. And you know, I thought I couldn't possibly sleep after all that had happened, but incredibly, after some time, I fell asleep without meaning to. When I woke up, I was startled. The morning sun was out, and it was shining, and a beautiful day was starting like nothing had ever happened. So I know you're wondering, am I still afraid? Has this changed my life? Let me answer the best I can. I still go to the cabin. I still love it. Nothing could change that for me, I don't think. I have never seen anything of a Sasquatch up there before, and nor have I since. I cannot explain why it came or what it did. As for changing my life, I think it's best to say that it's changed how I see things in life. It's opened me up to other possibilities, and I find I'm a lot less likely to dismiss other stories I read. Cautiously, I did tell a few people that were close to me, but I was very, very careful, given my career. Let's face it, no one wants their grandmother's oncologist to be that kook who says a Sasquatch was in his cabin one night. Seriously, few, if any, people would have faith in me in terms of medical ability to treat them. And for what it's worth, I understand that. Because before all of this happened to me, I would have quickly distanced myself from anyone in my field or in any medical field that I had to work with if they were known to be talking about Sasquatches or Loch Ness Monster or UFOs. That's the sad truth of how it is in our career fields. And so, Nance, this is where it all comes together. You see, you mentioned that Ruby Creek incident on your live stream, but you also mentioned how people sometimes do not want to go on record with their experiences because of credibility or legal issues. I am the person whose career would be damaged if I talked about this. That's right, me. I'm that person. So thank you for being an outlet for people like me. Not everyone out there that sees one of these things wants to make a formal, on-the-record, photograph me, put my name in the paper, and print my address all over the internet kind of reports. But until my dying day, I will swear that this is the truth. It's an improbable and wild story, I grant you. But it is the truth. You can believe it or not, I do not care. You see, I followed my dad's advice in many ways all through my life. And he always said, live below your means, save big, and invest deeply. What that means is, in just a few short years, I can retire. And when I retire, I will not have to care what anyone says. For now, please keep me anonymous. I'm sorry, but it's the way it has to be. Thank you. All right, everyone. Well, thank you for staying with me through this long journey tonight. I really do love these long stories. I wish I got more of them. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. You know, I had no idea that saying that on the live stream would prompt someone to write something like that in, but it really blew me away. Sometimes I get emails and it's weeks before I put them on the air just because I have other things lined up. I did put someone's email off to next week in order to put this up. I did let them know and they were fine with it. But other than Ruby Creek, I'm not aware of any Sasquatch entering a home, a cabin. Maybe I've missed some. If so, and you guys know about them, link me whatever you have on them in the video or in the comments below. I would really like to read up on those. Those fascinate me. It just seems odd. I always thought they never really came close to your homes or where you're camping. I always thought they would observe from a distance. That was my impression for years and years and years. But I guess I'm wrong. So anyway, and speaking of Dee, she was the second story. If you are interested in Dee's other stories, I will have links to her other stories down below in the video comments. All right, everyone. Well, I think that is going to do it for now. I will be back next week, and I'm going to try to get some pictures of little Sassy Sage. She's been a little hellion this week, so what can I say? She runs the show here. She is my little furry overlord. Anyway, folks, until we meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.